Hello and welcome back to the NLM Curation at Scale workshop. This will be a poster session. It is difficult to have an online poster session. We are not able to move around and look at each poster and talk to each author, but we're going to do our best in this virtual meeting. The poster authors have each submitted a flash talk for their projects that they are presenting here. I will be playing those flash talks in order. Please remember their number, their title and author, and use the Q&A to ask the questions. The poster authors are present and they have joined me today in this session, and they are ready to answer the questions that you have in real time via Q&A and chat. They will also post related links and more information regarding their posters as needed after their flash talks are playing. So without further ado, let's start with our first stop. Poster number one, it's Acknowledge Using Artificial Intelligence to Enhance Community Curation by Kimberly Van Oken.
Thank you for the opportunity to share our work on the Acknowledge system, an artificial intelligence enhanced community curation system. Biological knowledge bases are tasked with the challenge of curating a large and increasingly expanding corpus of literature. To date, two approaches have helped to make curation more efficient. The first is community curation, whereby authors enter data of different types and levels of detail, typically of newly published papers. The second is artificial intelligence, whereby various types of machine learning assist in tasks such as named entity recognition, data type flagging, and fact extraction. At Wormbase, we recently developed a system known as Acknowledge for author curation to knowledge base that combines these two approaches to assist authors in the curatorial process and lower the barrier to participation. The basic workflow of Acknowledge is shown on the right. Post-publication PDFs are converted to text, which then serves as the input for data type flagging, entity extraction, and in the future, sentence-level classification and fact extraction. Results are presented to authors for validation, after which curators perform quality control and submit the data to the knowledge base. This slide shows two panels of the form Authors Complete. Our goal with the Acknowledge system is to identify experimentally relevant data. So after entity recognition, we apply empirically derived rules such as TF-IDF or thresholds to filter some entities. In addition, we employ state-of-the-art neural networks to flag 9 different data types. We are very grateful to the C. elegans community for their participation and help to incentivize by prioritizing community curation and highlighting community curated papers throughout Wormbase, as shown here on one of our Wormbase person pages. We recently received funding from the National Library of Medicine to further develop the Acknowledge system in two key ways. First, we increasingly see papers that publish experiments on multiple organisms, including all organisms now part of the Alliance of Genome Resources. We will begin to expand the pipeline to extract data for these additional organisms, thus maximizing author effort. Further, we are testing sentence similarity methods to extract relevant sentences for curation that will be used to pre-populate forms for authors to perform fact extraction. Thank you to everyone involved in this project, including our group at Caltech, the Alliance of Genome Resources, Wormbase, and the C. elegans community.
Let's move on to poster number two. It will be presented by Federica Qualia, International Society for Biocuration, Mission and Goals in 2022. Let's listen to her flash talk.
Hi, I'm Federica, and I'm one of the members of the Executive Committee of the International Society for Biocuration. The International Society for Biocuration, ISB, is a professional society that promotes the field of biocuration, but also communications and exchanges between curators. There are several benefits for the ISB members, such as awards and funding opportunities. We do also have several meetings and workshops and conferences that curators can attend. On our dedicated ISB website, we regularly advertise career opportunities for new job openings, but also volunteering opportunities and training courses and workshops. You can find us on our dedicated website, but also on our Twitter account and YouTube channel, where you can also find the recordings of our previous conferences. And you can get to know more about the ISB and our updates by subscribing to our mailing list on Simple List. The society is overseen by a committee of 9 members. With a chair, a secretary, a treasurer, and other 6 members. We also host yearly biocuration conferences. And in 2022, we are going to host a face-to-face regional meeting in the UK, Cambridge, early May, but also a general virtual conference, the ISB 2022, that is going to be virtual, and it's going to feature 3 sessions during the year, starting April 7. And if you want to know more or you have questions about the society, please feel free to get in touch with us using our email account. And thank you for your attention.
As a reminder, please use the poster number and/or author while directing your questions. As I said, the poster authors have joined me in this session, and they are eager to answer your questions. Moving on to poster number 3, Maine matched the notation from NCBI and EMBL-EBI by Shashi Puyar.
Hello, I'm Shashi Pujar, and my presentation is about a collaboration called Matched Annotation from NCBI and EMBL-EBI, or MAIN. Since the availability of the human genome sequence, NCBI's REFSEQ and EMBL-EBI's Ensemble GenCode have provided comprehensive annotation of human protein coding genes. Some applications, such as clinical genomics, require the use of one transcript per gene. Additionally, customers often prefer to have consistent annotation from both the groups rather than choose between them. The MAIN collaboration was initiated to address these needs and presently offers 2 products. One, the MAIN Select, which is a representative transcript that is identically annotated end-to-end in the 2 annotations with synonymous REFSEQ and Ensemble identifiers. It matches the human reference genome 100% and is meant to serve as a universal standard for clinical variant reporting and default display in genomic resources. Second, the MAIN Plus Clinical, which is meant to be used in addition for genes where the MAIN Select alone is not sufficient to report clinical variants. The MAIN products can be accessed in several ways, including NCBI and Ensemble Gene Pages and browsers, Ensemble BioMart, UCSC Genome Browser, and the MAIN FTP page. The table here shows the current status of the MAIN dataset. Release 1.0, which came out last month, covers 99% of the human protein coding genes and almost all of the clinically relevant genes. The MAIN workflow involves selection of a transcript per gene by an automated process developed independently by each annotation group. Curated transcripts are chosen by the 2 pipelines based on biologically relevant criteria. Matching of selected transcripts and harmonizing their 5' and 3' ends is done by an automated process. A joint group of curators review corner cases that cannot be decided computationally. In the last 3 years, we have got a great response to MAIN from the clinical user community. Several public genome resources, such as those listed here, now display MAIN Select transcripts, which we hope will encourage broader adoption of these transcripts as universal standards. We welcome user feedback at the contact emails shown here. We hope to complete the main select set in the next few months. Main plus clinical is expected to be a dynamic set with transcripts added in future based on user requests and new reported clinical variants. Stay tuned for the main paper in the journal Nature, which is expected to be published soon. With that, I'd like to end this presentation. Thank you for listening.
This is poster number 4, PharmCat, VCF preprocessor for robust pharmacogenomics annotation. It will be presented by Binglang Li from Stanford University.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming to this poster. In this poster, we want to introduce PharmCat VCF preprocessor that addresses one of the challenges in automating pharmacogenomics annotation. Pharmacogenomics, or PGX, investigates the genetic influence on drug response and contributes to the success of precision medicine by facilitating clinical decision-making for drug prescribing recommendations and adherence. Before I get into the specific challenge that this poster addresses, I want to introduce the tool PharmCat. PharmCat stands for Pharmacogenomics Clinical Annotation Tool. PharmCat takes a VCF file and optionally a file of PGX diplotypes from external callers, digests genetic information, and generates a detailed PGX report. The development of PharmCat in combination with the decreasing cost of clinical genetic tests make it possible to integrate genotype-based drug prescribing recommendations with routine clinical practice. However, currently, one bottleneck of clinical implementation of PGX has something to do with the diverse variant representation format that one can find in input VCF. VCFs may record genetic variants in different variant representation formats, usually as a direct result of distinct bioinformatics pipelines in different genetic testing labs that generate these VCFs. Differences in variant representation formats may sway PGX annotation results and thus impede PharmCat from automating PGX annotation. To address this issue, we developed the VCF preprocessor that normalizes and standardizes VCF for PGX annotations. The only mandatory input for PharmCat VCF preprocessor is the VCF file that you want to use for PharmCat. PharmCat VCF preprocessor will normalize and standardize your input VCF and provide two sets of output. One is single sample VCF files that are PharmCat ready and suffixed with sample ID, and the other is a report of missing PGX positions in your input VCF that PharmCat uses and needs for defining PGX named alleles. The users are also able to provide a list of VCFs as input, which is convenient for large-scale analysis where genetic data is usually broken down into multiple VCFs. There are also many more functions that's provided with PharmCat VCF preprocessor. More information can be found in PharmCat GitHub repository. The PharmCat VCF preprocessor has been tested with VCFs from UK Biobank and Penn Medicine Biobank. The script is part of the PharmCat releases. For latest function, you can use the development branch. We're also providing detailed walkthrough and tutorials in the GitHub wiki. We welcome any feedback, and please feel free to submit GitHub issues. And this project is put together by this awesome team, and we thank NHGRI for its funding.
Let's move on to poster number 5, Curation Beyond the Genes, Approaches for Producing the RevSeq Functional Elements Dataset, presented by Catherine Farrell of NCBI. Let's listen to her talk.
Hi, I'm Catherine Farrell from NCBI, and I'm presenting on RevSeq functional elements. While the mainstream RevSeq dataset is defined for genes, RevSeq FEs are defined for experimentally validated non-genic regions. Their types include gene regulatory elements, known structural elements, and other functionally important regions. They're produced as RevSeqs with robust use of INSDCJ standards, with other terms in the sequence ontology and evidence strings from the ECO. They also include NCBI genome annotation and are fully indexed and updatable. They're curated from experimental evidence in the literature, where some are based on focus region studies, which require heavy manual curation, while others are based on high throughput studies, which are more scalable. They currently include curation from over 2,200 publications. Note that the dataset has not scoped for curation of omics data as found in other gene regulatory resources. Therefore, RevSeq FEs represent a complementary literature-derived resource. Our data model includes descriptive records in NCBI's gene database, Sequence records in the nucleotide database include experimental evidence types and links to publications, genome annotation of features with metadata, and gene regulatory and recombination interactions, which are based on known activity. We provide multiple data access options, including FTP downloads, graphical displays, and a track hub, as detailed on our webpage. Here is an example of feature annotation for the opsin locus control region on GDV, and here's our track hub view of the alpha globin locus, including interaction tracks. In recent annotation releases, the dataset had almost 13,000 features for human and 2,300 features for mouse. We recently achieved almost twofold record growth based on evidence from large-scale studies by using automatic record production, effective data wrangling, and bulk editing. High-confidence data is increasingly becoming available, and techniques are constantly evolving for non-genic assays. We hope to substantially grow the dataset by using such large-scale data and through automated and semi-automated approaches. Also, watch out for a new human annotation release coming this month. While we aim for scalable growth, we will nevertheless continue to do focus curation for high-value regions, such as our data subset for human host regions associated with coronavirus biology. The resource can be used for discovery of non-coding genome function, as positive controls for epigenomic data evaluation, for genetic variant interpretation, and as reference standards for functional interactions. Lots more details can be found on our webpage, in our recent publication, and in NCBI blog posts. We welcome feedback and can be contacted by email, feedback button on our webpage, and through our user mail interface. Thank you for listening.
This is our stop number 6, Curation Strategies of the Immune Epitope Database by Randy Vita from La Jolla Institute for Immunology.
I'm Randy Vita, and this presentation is on the curation strategies of the Immune Epitope Database. We rely on manual biocuration, automated curation support tools, and a source of terminology system to accurately and efficiently curate experimental data from the literature. We are able to achieve consistent data entry via manual biocuration using our team of PhD curators who use a curation manual and external experts to translate published experimental data into our well-defined data structure. Efficient data entry is made possible by automated curation support tools, which enable automated query and classification of the literature, as well as autocomplete functionality, informed validation, ontology-driven finder applications, and post-curation calculations. By exploiting the logical relationships between the ontology terms used in our data model, logical validation is made possible. For example, in our immune exposure process model, particular in vivo process types lead to specific diseases, which are caused by specific pathogens. Our ontology-driven finder applications allow our curators to utilize shortcuts using ontology-provided abbreviations and common names, as well as browse terms presented in a hierarchical tree view. Additionally, we are able to extend external ontology resources to meet the needs of immunologists. For example, SARS-CoV-2 is a term that's found in the NCBI taxonomy. However, all the many variants of SARS-CoV-2 are not, and these variants are very important to immunologists, and we encounter them frequently in the literature, so they're therefore critical for our curators to capture this level of detail. When we need terms that are not yet present in the resources we're using, we add temporary terms, which we then manage using our source of terminology system. This system was developed to manage the use of many changing external ontologies and other resources. With the SOT, we're able to take in many different community standards, provide for custom immunology-friendly term labels for our users and curators, and manage those custom term requests, as well as the versioning of these external resources. Interoperability is then facilitated by a public API, allowing users to resolve queries for the terms that we use.
Our stop number 7, Doug, a semantic search engine for biomedical datasets, presented by Alex Waldrop of RTI International.
Hi, my name is Alex Waldrop, and I'm here to talk about Doug, a semantic search engine for biomedical datasets. So what is Doug, and what problems does it solve? Doug is designed to be something like a Google for biomedical datasets. You might ask yourself, why would anyone even need a search engine for biomedical data sets? After all, Google does exist, right? The answer is that funding agencies have spent the last decade generating huge amounts of data, thanks in part to advances like DNA sequencing. There's now more data than we even know what to do with, and even harder to find it. This is partly because projects have historically generated data within siloed databases. You can see several of the examples here from Import, ClinVar, dbGaP, data scattered across an otherwise disjoint ecosystem with few options to bridge across all of those different data silos. So that's why we can't just Google across the databases to find a data set of interest. Until now. We present DUG, which is designed to flexibly index data across these databases and present data sets in a single unique framework to people searching for data. So without more ado, let's talk about how DUG actually works. Borrowing from Google, DUG's streamlined search bar is designed to allow the user to simply type in what types of data sets they're interested in searching for. Let's say, for instance, I'm an endocrinologist looking for published studies with data about, say, diabetes. Now, DUG takes us to its results page. DUG organizes its study results by ontological concept. As we can see here, each one of these cards represents a different type of ontological concept that relates back to the initial search. So you can see here, when we click on the studies, it shows us which studies have variables that are related to these ontological concepts. The reason that DUG organizes its results by concept is to allow the user to browse quickly over the high-level concepts without having to dive down into, say the hundreds of variables that are returned by this single ontological concept. So it's a good way to sift through the landscape quickly. Now, if you want to actually see and drill down as to what studies have the data that you're interested in, you can click on that studies bar, and then it will take us to the actual studies, and then it will actually show us the name of the variables here. So in this cardia study right here, we see that there are five different measures of diabetes, and each one of these is linked out to a page where we can learn more about that variable of interest. We hope you enjoyed this demonstration on how DUG helps connect users with data across this disjointed ecosystem.
Let's move on to poster number 8 from NASA Gene Lab, Open Science for Life in Space. It will be presented by Sam Gebret. As a reminder, please direct your questions to the Q&A. Remember to enter the poster number and your author number. And our poster authors are happy to provide more information for their projects.
Hi, welcome to the NASA Gene Lab Open Science for Life in Space. My name is Sam Guppery, and I'm the Deputy Project Manager for Gene Lab. And today I'm just going to give a brief introduction on Gene Lab, focus on the curation elements for space omics, highlight our data repository, and give you an insight of our data model and standards and what's next for curation. So just as an overview, GeneLab is an open access database containing fully curated omics data for space relevant experiments. And in addition to our data, our GeneLab data system provides users various tools for data analysis, collaborative workspace for file storage and sharing, visualization portal, and training programs to train the next generation of space biologists. So what makes GeneLab unique? It's a repository of space-relevant omics data. It's extremely rare and valuable. We also collect a lot of space-specific metadata that's associated with the data. In addition, we use standardized pipelines to analyze and make higher order data available along with our raw data. We also have a web-based submission portal that allows PIs to enter their data and curate their metadata while they're generating the data. And here's a glimpse of a snapshot of what that submission portal looks like. And you can see it makes it very easy for you to edit and add metadata and associate it with the data files. This is a quick glimpse of our data repository. We have over 350 public studies across multiple assays and species. And half our data is from spaceflight experiments. The other one is from grand analogs. And as you can see here, there's several ways to search our database. You can use the search bar or search filters and also search across several federated databases. And once you click a study of interest, each study contains detailed metadata and raw and processed data files associated at a sample level. To highlight our data model and standard, we use the ISA framework, and this provides a rich description of the experimental data. It leverages ontologies, it supports linkage of data values, and also supports the standard guidelines for assays. And we strive to maintain fairness and usability, and here we highlight some of those features of our database to enable the FAIR principles. So what's next for our curation team? Because our data comes from multiple sources, we continue metadata harmonization across repositories. We're also currently integrating with the NASA Ames Life Sciences Data Archive, which hosts and collects phenotypic and non-omics data for space life sciences. And we will continue to curate with FAIR principles in mind and consider a more quantitative method for FAIR checking our databases to track improvement. And I want to thank and acknowledge the NASA GeneLab team and our funders, the NASA Biological and Space Sciences Division of the Science Mission Directorate. Thank you.
This is poster number 9, Accessibility Check and Fix for Auto-Remediation of Archived Documents, presented by Ian Smith of CodeMantra.
Today, I'd like to show you the power of CodeMantra's Accessibility Check and Accessibility Fix products. In the case of large-scale online document archives and catalogs, content is most often stored as image PDFs. This is certainly the case where the only available source is a hard copy that must be scanned and OCR'd. In this case, both the scanned image PDF and the text layer are captured and made available. In this instance, the image PDF auto-loads into an online viewer. The sighted user can easily peruse this document, follow the table of contents, and navigate to specific pages, chapters, or sections that are of most interest. For the visually impaired user, a text layer can be made available and a screen reader can be applied. But without any structural tags, the visually impaired user can only approach this document as a steady playback of continuous text. There can be no context or ability to navigate to relevant chapters or pages, as seen here. So let's take a look at the level of compliance of that image PDF. I've loaded that document into Accessibility Check, and we can view that full report. As seen here, the level of compliance is lacking. That is due to the lack of structure. As noted here, the PDF file does not contain tags. So let's create some tags. That is best done through Accessibility Fix. And we're going to initiate that process by selecting Start from Scratch. This process will take some time, and a little bit about what is happening. In the background, Accessibility Fix is looking at each and every page using artificial intelligence and machine learning to predict PDF structure. Your proprietary artificial intelligence and machine learning algorithms within Fix earned CodeMantra's Accessibility Insight the 2021 Cody Award for Best Artificial Intelligence-Enabled Content Solution. Accessibility Fix is indeed a black box, and can be integrated with any on-prem workflow solution. So now, as we see here within Accessibility Review, this is our editor and viewer that allows a user to see that structure. This is essentially a replacement for Acrobat. But as we navigate through pages that contain content, we can see that there is now the presence of structure. We have our heading ones, all of the paragraphs, certain content identified as images. And we can go on through the document. The fundamental point here is that now this once non-compliant PDF has structure, enabling that navigation capability by users of assistive technologies. They can come to the TOC, which has been recognized as an actual TOC, enabling them to navigate to the respective sections and/or chapters. We see the headings here identifying this new section of this document, life insurance, and the following paragraphs. Along with the structure, the logical reading order has been identified as well. We scroll further throughout the document. We see the presence of tables. Tables have also been automatically identified and tagged properly. We have our table with the associated table heads and data cells. So Accessibility Fix is indeed a black box. And with an API connector, it can be integrated into an existing on-prem workflow to provide an auto remediation solution without human intervention of any kind. A quick look at how that may work is shown here. So I appreciate your time. Have a great day.
We are midway through our poster journey. This is poster number 10, Faith-Based, a community-driven approach to large-scale biocuration. And it will be presented to us by Robert Schuller from University of Southern California. Let's listen to his flash talk.
Hello, I'm Rob Schuller, and I'll be presenting work on behalf of the Faith-Based Consortium on a community-driven approach to large-scale biocuration. Faith-Based began in 2009 with the goal to serve as the trusted online data resource for craniofacial and dental researchers worldwide. It began as a hub and spoke consortium with dedicated projects tasked with generating and contributing data to the hub. But in beginning in 2019, we shifted gears into an open community model. No more dedicated spokes, and it was open to all. With the challenge, could we engage a community not required to contribute data and commit the effort to curate it themselves? And so began an experiment in self-serve data curation, which we sometimes dub as self-curation. We began by building on a FAIR data platform. You can learn more about that at deriva.isi.edu. We applied key principles of our method were to stay agnostic with respect to the database model for any systems and components that we develop. We start with a simple database model and update incrementally with user input, provide intuitive tools, processes, and training in the curation process, and then reduce human effort through automated data pipelines. So, we developed this conceptual model really with our users in the loop and evolved it incrementally with their feedback. We present this now to scientists as a simple way that they can understand our overall structure of the Faith-Based data model. It gives them a mental map as they're navigating our system and curating data. Our process begins with an online tutorial, which involves training in our online forms shown at the top left. And these forms help to ensure integrity of data as it comes in, rather than kind of an after-the-fact process that you go through with, say, spreadsheets that have to be cleansed and integrated into a database. There are desktop tools shown at the bottom that help with the upload and linking in of any data files contributed. And then a number of automated pipelines, not necessarily depicted here, but one of which is the quality control aspect, which is performed online in the background and gives them immediate feedback about their data. We've seen great growth in terms of contributing projects and in data set contributions, doubling the number of projects contributing data and released over 100 data sets. And we recently reached the 1,000th data set milestone. We've also seen really broader and more varied data collection. So in terms of the types of experiments and the biological characteristics, both have really grown by several factors over this time. And then robust volume of data has been collected across the board in sequencing and imaging with a large spike in our imaging data recently. So thank you for your time. And if you'd like to learn more, please visit us on the web.
Let's move on to our stop number 11, Heron, Health Knowledge Graph Extraction, presented by Christopher Cervantes from Johns Hopkins University.
Hello, everyone. My name is Chris Cervantes. I'm from the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory, and I'd like to talk about the ongoing work that we've been doing with the Heron project. The overall goal of Heron is to take unstructured biomedical text, like PubMed articles, and create representations of entities and how they relate. Specifically, we're looking to extract knowledge graphs, where nodes are entities and edges are typed relations. These knowledge graphs can be used in a number of ways, from facilitating content exploration, so understanding what's in a group of documents, to helping downstream applications like search or question answering, and even aiding in ontology creation. In our baseline approach, we consider this knowledge graph extraction task as having three pieces: named entity recognition, where are the entities and to what type do they belong, relation extraction, determining if entity mentions are related, and composition, which brings everything together. For our initial experiments, we rely on the publicly available BioRelics dataset, which annotates sentences from biomedical journals with entities, like proteins, and the binding relation, so protein A binds to protein B. In our NAR system, we fine-tune existing SPACI models for scientific texts on this dataset. In the poster's examples, so here the ground truth is in green, correct predictions are in blue, the incorrect is in red, we can see that we're doing pretty well. So in that top example, we get everything correct but the class of the last mention. But we have some room for improvement, especially around the less frequent entity types. For our baseline relation extraction system, we use a BERT-based match the blanks model, which for these purposes can be thought of as predicting a confidence for whether an ordered pair of entity mentions are related. In this example, we're correctly predicting the first link, we miss the second link, but we importantly do not predict the spurious links between all the other ordered pairs of mentions. Finally, we use a naive composition approach to combine our sentence level predictions. As with NAR, we do best around proteins since they are the most frequent label in the dataset. But one interesting phenomena that we're highlighting in this poster is that there are a number of instances where we correctly predict that two entities are related, but we misclassify the direction of that relation. So we say that A binds to B rather than B binds to A. Altogether, these baselines are a first step toward Heron's overall goal. In our next phase, we're looking to broaden our scope, refine our models, and incorporate additional world knowledge. Thank you.
Our poster number 12, using expert language for enhanced PubMed search, visual document comparison assistance in identification of relevant articles, presented by Stuart Eden from Vocalize.
Welcome to Vocalize. My name is Stuart Eaton. At Vocalize, we specialize in reading documents using a novel and powerful method that starts with a document or abstract as opposed to a word. We believe our reader will assist curators and researchers in finding PubMed articles relevant to their particular interest. As this is a curation workshop, I'm going to start with a paper called The Art of Curation at a Biological Database. Quoting from that paper, the majority of curation at Grain Genes is paper-centric, meaning that our efforts are focused around extracting all the crucial research outcomes from one specific study published in a peer-reviewed journal. The researchers obviously read the whole document, but let's just start with the abstract. And obviously, if they then look for further reading, they go to PubMed and find similar articles. And obviously, they'll click on those and read them. So that's that approach. Now let's turn to our approach. Turning to our approach, what we're exploiting is that the source material is experts writing for their peers, so using the vocabulary and terminology of their discipline. The document reader exploits this requirement to use a common professional language by using the whole of an abstract research proposal as the material for comparison with all the abstracts contained in a subset that we collect from PubMed. That is, it is not searching, but evaluating similarity based on a co-occurrence of vocabulary and terms in the source document in each of the abstracts. So let's actually go to an example that we've got on the screen. On the top left-hand side is the starting abstract, which in this case is the abstract from the paper on curation of a biological database. We set the number of abstracts that we'd like to see at 25. We then ask it to look into the subset called Wheat, which contains 73,533 related files that we've built from PubMed. On the right-hand side, you can see the word and term frequency ranking with our starting abstract at the top. The list in the middle is the 25 abstracts in ranked order based on word and term commonality. Clearly, we can't tell you whether these are actually relevant, but the more terms and words there are would imply this is the case. You can relate this to what happens in the PubMed search, and they appear but in a completely different order. I'll show you one more example, this time with a very large data set, over 233,000 files, and this has been built all around COVID-19. Our starting point was an article by Palab Ghosh, the BBC science correspondent, who's talking about xenon gas being used to examine lung damage on COVID patients. This search takes around 30 seconds, and you can see on the right-hand side of the slide the data. The top one comes out, shows the result of the study, whereas the second one is the actual study that an article was based on. So you can start with something inside PubMed or outside. I hope this gives you a brief insight into what we do. Please visit our website if you'd like to hear more. Thank you very much for listening.
Air poster number 13, cross-domain and extensible semantic metadata annotation service adapted to the medical domain, presented by Julia Sasse from Information Center for Life Sciences, Germany.
Hello, my name is Julia Sasse, and in this short video, I will introduce you to our semantic metadata annotation service. Together with Johannes Dams and Juliane Flug, we developed the service in the NFDI for Health project at ZBMed, Information Center for Life Sciences. What is NFDI for Health and why do we develop such an annotation service? NFDI for Health is the national research data infrastructure for personal health data in Germany, and NFDI for Health supports researchers to share data generated in clinical trials, epidemiological and public health studies in a fair manner. Based on the FAIR principles, services are provided to researchers to permanently store, semantically enrich, and share data in interoperable form and to merge data from different sources. One important aspect of FAIR is the I, interoperability of case report forms, data dictionaries, and questionnaires. Using FAIR vocabularies for metadata annotation is key to reusing and combining results from independent research studies. Our metadata annotation service presented in this poster helps with the semantic enrichment by integration of semantic codes into study metadata. During the annotation process, the researcher is confronted with the data in a standard and non-standard formats and plenty of variables to annotate. Through the help of the annotation service, which provides relevant terminologies and ontologies and semi-automated annotation support with the user in the loop, we support the creation of interoperable version of the data collection instruments. First, we identified basic requirements for semantic metadata annotation software in the biomedical field and in the context of NFDI for Health and the FAIR principles. For example, the support of common and domain-specific data formats. We started with common table formats such as Excel spreadsheet questionnaires and will extend in the future with more specific formats such as FHIR. Other features of the service are terminology search and suggestion. The user can search for concepts within integrated terminologies and ontologies and will be offered suggestions for semantic concept annotations for each data element in a semi-autonomous process. Currently, an interface to the semantic lookup service SemLookP exists, an ontology lookup service instance with selected biomedical resources. While some metadata annotation services already exist, they are in many cases tailored to specific data formats and terminologies, or they do not meet all basic prerequisites. The first prototype of a metadata annotation service we present meets the basic requirements and can be adapted to specific use cases. Currently, the annotation service is being further adapted for a use case in the medical domain with a SNOMED terminology and standards such as HL7 FHIR as additional requirements.
Moving on to our poster number 14, Warfighter Health Data Commons Design Features for Curation at Scale, Matthew Dinmore, Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory.
My name is Matthew Dinmore. I work at the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab, and this poster is about our work in designing a Warfighter Health Data Commons for curation at scale. There is operational need for an accessible repository of artificial intelligence-ready Warfighter Health data in support of modern life-saving applications. This poster introduces key design features of the Warfighter Health Data Commons and how they support the goal of securely providing accessible, research-ready data for military medical capabilities. The WHDC is designed to address several use cases, including submission of data for sharing and research, data harmonization, data discovery, analysis and collaboration for conducting research, and the ability to produce data-driven warfighter medicine applications. A wide range of health-related data types is needed to address different research and development challenges, demanding large-scale data infrastructure, efficient data engineering, and guaranteed conformance to policy and security requirements. These needs are achieved in the design through agile data engineering and policy as code. The use of data standards is a key aspect of WHDC's concept of operations. However, the wide variety of legacy systems also requires the ability to deal with non-standard data types at scale. A composable data engineering layer based on the open source Apache NiFi system facilitates several key functions, including normalization and harmonization, metadata extraction, and data-focused policy enforcement, such as de-identification. Human-in-the-loop requirements are supported through an integrated business-style workflow system. A key design tenet is that data and policy are coupled throughout the data lifecycle. Just as data is manipulated via the data engineering workflows between datasets, the policy governing that data may also be manipulated. Policy as code captures policy terms associated with a dataset. These might be drawn from data use agreements, organizational or legal policies, or approved institutional review board protocols. Importantly, these terms may be computed on, much like a smart contract, to help manage policy interactions. The combination of data engineering and policy as code can be visualized as a chain, with each step in a dataset's lifecycle represented by nodes and each link between nodes representing the computed data and policy changes. This allows the data engineering and policy actions performed on a dataset to be documented and audited throughout the lifecycle. Changes can also be more easily propagated, though we don't expect that this will ever be fully automated because of the human intricacies of policy management. The WHDC's combination of agile data engineering workflows and policy as code provide a robust solution to managing warfighter health data at scale.
We are approaching the end of our journey. We have three more posters to go. Number 15 is presented by Ali Garland Gray from RTI International. The poster is titled "Heal Distributed Data Ecosystem, a Use Case for Curation at Scale." Let's listen to Ali.
Hi, everyone. Our poster was prepared by Mary Hannah Curran, Usman Sao, Maria Davila, and myself, Ali Garland Gray. The Helping to End Addiction Long-Term Initiative, or HEAL Initiative, is a trans-agency effort with over 900 studies collectively generating a diverse array of research data to provide scientific solutions to the opioid crisis. The HEAL data ecosystem is part of this initiative and enables new discoveries by accelerating the sharing of HEAL-generated data and results. Knowing this, we set out to determine the most appropriate data sharing model for the HEAL data ecosystem. To achieve our goal, we reviewed three conceptual models of data sharing: centralized, distributed, and federated. Differences between the three models are summarized in the following comparison table. The distributed system was selected based on the system's need for rapid deployment and cost effectiveness. This image represents the HEAL distributed data ecosystem. In this model, researchers submit both data and metadata to the repositories and only metadata to the HEAL platform. The platform aims to speed scientific discoveries by making research outcomes more findable and accessible through a metadata catalog. Curation entails a multitude of activities that help to describe, package, and administer research data and metadata. In this ecosystem, curation can occur at many levels, including with the investigators, the repositories, and the data coordinating centers. Now that we know this model, we want to identify the best way to apply FAIR principles across this data landscape. The preceding efforts help to guide researchers through the research data lifecycle by following best practices for data management and curation. In order to make the data FAIR, the stewards continue to develop resources to aid in the different aspects of curation. This includes a repository selection guide and implementation of metadata standards. The state of FAIR image on the right shows the process of moving towards fairness throughout the research data lifecycle in the context of the HEAL ecosystem. The resulting benefits of FAIR include secondary analysis and meta-analysis. Data curation and FAIR principles work in conjunction to best serve the scientific community. This is at the heart of the HEAL initiative. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. Thank you for listening.
And welcome back. We are now at poster number 16, Iterative Development of Gold Standard Data for Machine Curation by Matthew Turner from Georgia State University.
My name is Matt Turner, and I'm presenting today on iterative development of gold standard data for machine curation. I work on neurobridges.org, which is a platform for data discovery that enhances the reuse of clinical and neuroimaging data from already published studies. We'll focus on just one aspect of our annotation work, and that is the management of complexity. Our project requires the annotation of published neuroimaging studies. We select and annotate studies with shared data available to enable data reuse. We derived our annotation methods from modern software development techniques. There are a variety of these techniques, and we used a combination of ideas from them to create a coherent approach to annotation. A key principle is that when managing complexity, there are reasons to both increase the complexity and to reduce it. In part of our work, we used a mixture of spreadsheets, highlighting of documents directly, and cut and paste methods, and this enabled the development of the ontology. This needed flexibility came with an increased complexity of the tools used. In another part, we used annotation software for markup of the actual documents, and in these situations, we reduced the complexity exposed to the annotators, which decreased the variability in their work. Specifically, we used a two-phase approach. The first phase was the co-development of the ontology and the draft annotations for the corpus of documents. The initial terms were added to the ontology by experts, but very quickly, as the annotators began highlighting the text of the PDF papers, they found cases that were not clearly covered by the ontology. As the annotators discovered these cases, the experts would revise the terminology, but this took time. The flexibility we needed here was the ability for the annotators to label things without having ontological terms at the ready, and for the ontologist to be able to revise the ontology without stopping the labeling process. The combination of using spreadsheets to hold language samples, highlights on original PDF documents to mark the text, and periodic reviews by the ontologist allowed us to develop both the ontology and the draft set of labels in parallel. The results of this phase were the expanded ontology, the highlighted PDFs of papers, which were to draft text locations, spreadsheets with language samples and draft annotations, most of which were fully correct by the end of this part of the process, and a set of trained annotators. Next came the formal corpus markup, which was done with annotation software. The annotators were now marking up the papers directly in a computer-readable format. The materials from phase one acted as sources here. The presence of draft annotations allowed rapid formal markup of the corpus. These materials also acted as training materials for new annotators. This approach allowed us to reduce the management effort required by the experts and to focus their work on quality checking and giving the annotators feedback. With increasing skill, annotators were able to advance to doing other curation tasks. And the product of this phase is the first version of the actual machine-readable corpus. Thank you.
Welcome back, and let's move on to our stop number 17, which will be presented by Janet Pinheiro, Trends in the Landscape of Biomarkers in Clinical Trials. As a reminder, please use your Q&A to direct any questions that you may have to the authors.
My name is Janet Pinheiro, and I am a postdoctoral researcher at the Research Program on Biomedical Informatics, which is a joint research program of the Hospital del Mar Medical Research Institute and the Pompeu Fabra University. The work that I will present today has been carried out in collaboration with MedBioinformatics Solutions, a company that aims to exploit biomedical data to support drug discovery pipelines and to enhance biomedical research. In this contribution, we have developed and applied a pipeline to extract and normalize the information about gene and protein biomarkers contained in the clinical trial database. We obtained the data via the Clinical Trial Transformation Initiative, comprising over 400,000 different clinical studies. After the name entity recognition step, we are able to extract and normalize over 3,000 gene and protein biomarker mentions that comprise 2,600 diseases in 43,000 clinical studies. Then we curated a selection of approximately 1,000 sentences from the measurement section of the clinical trials retrieved from the previous steps, and we then developed a corpus, which is for a classification scheme to annotate the biomarker to a specific type. The next step was then to train a machine learning classifier to assign the rest of the entries to these different categories. This is an example of some of the entries of the manually annotated corpus. In this figure, we show the most frequent biomarkers measured in four different therapeutic areas. Here in the x-axis, we show the year of the first clinical trial, and in this plot, each circle denotes one biomarker. The colors indicate the biomarker type, and the size of the dot is proportional to the number of the clinical trials in which the biomarker has been identified. You can see here that some biomarkers, like for example hemoglobin and albumin and some liver enzymes, are common to all therapeutic areas, while other biomarkers, like for example the protein ACE2, is specific of infection, or the genes KRAS and BRAF are specific for neoplasms, while for example APOE and COMT are genes specific of mental disorders. In summary, we have developed and applied a text mining pipeline to extract fine-grained information about biomarkers measured in clinical studies. Over 3,000 biomarkers are associated to 2,600 different conditions identified from 43,000 different clinical studies. We also developed a classification scheme to describe the different types of biomarkers used in these studies. Finally, our data analytics pipeline allows us to find trends in the biomarkers used and the related conditions, to assess biomarker specificity, and to discover emerging patterns about biomarkers of disease. Thank you.
Last but not the least, poster number 18, COVID-19 preprint review at scale, presented by Anita Bandrovsky.
Hi, my name is Anita Bandrovsky. I am the founder and CEO of PsyCrunch Inc. And I'm here to ask whether the artificial intelligence community can help review preprints at scale. Tools that can be used and are currently being used to replace humans, at least in part, are listed here on the left-hand side, including PsyScore. This is our tool, but there are lots of other tools like JetFighter, Barzooka, which both check images for different aspects of quality. Seek and Blast, trial registration screener, which verifies clinical trials, ODPUB, which screens the presence of open data and open code, Limitation Recognizer, which recognizes self-acknowledged limitation statements, and of course CiteAI, which detects citations of retracted papers, as well as R Transparent. All of these tools currently work together look at the aspects of rigor and reproducibility in the COVID preprint literature. What happens in general is that preprints are extracted from bioarchive and medarchive, then they're broken into images or text, and the appropriate portions of the preprint are passed to the various tools that either recognize images or text. Everything is then consolidated into a database and an HTML report, which is then provided to the authors using Hypothesis and Twitter. This is what one of those looks like. So what you can see here are some of the Landis criteria being pulled out for this particular preprint in MedArchive. Antibodies and other reagents are actually being listed out here with different RIDs that would be suggested here, but they are not. And the other tools are again listed, and they detect various things, including ODPUB, which in this case did not detect any open code, and Trial Identifier, which did in fact detect this particular clinical trial. Now, we've already published a portion of this where we looked at how well the authors of preprints are doing in terms of some of the Landis criteria. So, for example, randomization, blinding, and power analysis, as well as sex as a biological variable, are generally present in a very low number of the preprints. It is a higher number if you consider the published literature. So 50% of the PubMed Central corpus does contain some of these criteria, whereas a much smaller percentage of the preprint corpus. Again, this has been published as a preliminary report in 2021, and I'd like to thank you for your attention.
That was the end of our journey. We would like to thank you all for visiting all the posters, for engaging in chat and Q&A with the speakers. We hope you have had a review of 18 very interesting projects, and you will have the desire to go and learn more about them. Right now, I am ending the session as we prepare for our next one, chaired by Mike Huerta. Thank you all for joining the NLM Curation at Scale workshop, and we'll see you in the next session.